How New Zealanders get around is becoming more and more important as we try and reduce our emissions, but it's been hugely difficult in recent weeks. A monumental failure is how KiwiRail's Wellington service disruptions are being described by the Greater Wellington Regional Council. Since yesterday, Wellington trains are running slower, resulting in reduced timetables, while necessary inspections are carried out across the network. It's seen the government to launch a rapid review into KiwiRail to see whether it's appropriately focused on the delivery of reliable commuter services. But the problem isn't just on KiwiRail's train tracks. The Inter-Islander ferry, owned and operated by KiwiRail, has been plagued with issues over the last few months. Cancellations, delays, equipment breakdowns, staff shortages, all resulting in very unhappy passengers. Well, yesterday on Breakfast, KiwiRail's Paul Ashton apologised for the train service disruptions.
Firstly, I'd like to apologise to all of the commuters in Wellington for the disruption we are going to cause them in their travel around the region this week. This is clearly solely in KiwiRail's responsibility.
Yeah, but the big question is, how do you turn those words into actions? Infrastructure New Zealand's Nick Leggett joins us now alongside National's infrastructure spokesperson, Chris Bishop. Morena Kōrua, thank you both so much for being with us and squeezing into our Wellington studio as well. Really appreciate it. Hey, Nick, we should be doing better than this, shouldn't we?
Oh, we absolutely should. I mean, this is the result of a collective national mindset around deferral and underinvestment over many, many years. And it pops out with little issues like this, but there are other exposures around, not just in rail, but actually all parts of infrastructure in New Zealand. I mean, that's why we've got three water reform. For some reason, we have this culture of deferral. We don't think about what's under the ground. Once we've built it, we just sort of let it rock. And we don't have the knowledge or the information about assets to know when we need to spend more on them to upgrade them or renew them.
Yeah, well, it seems a little bit ridiculous that we have one machine that is about 41 years old to do an incredibly important job, and it is that one machine that is causing so much disruption. I wonder how much KiwiRail, how much responsibility do they have to take? We had Michael Woods, the Minister for Transport, on earlier this morning. He's put the blame firmly at their feet, saying mistakes were made and it isn't good enough. Should we be laying the blame completely at KiwiRail's feet?
Well, I mean, they own and operate the network on behalf of the government. They've been given significant amount of money, billions of dollars, over the last few years to invest in rail and the rail network. And they ultimately hold not only the purse strings, but the ability to do work on the network. And that, to me, means that who else is responsible, really? But it does, you know, when there are, you know, when something as small as this can grind a train network and a whole transport network in the Wellington region to a standstill, you have to ask, who's looking out for the risk? Who's actually asking these questions? And, you know, as a country, we've underinvested in infrastructure. This is just one more example. And as I say, we've got to collectively lift our headspace to a point where we're thinking ahead, we're looking at the risk, and most critically, we're investing and renewing those critical assets that keep us going on a daily basis.
Yeah, Chris, can I bring you in here and ask where you think some of that responsibility should lie? Should some of it land with the government? We know that they've invested billions over the past few years into the infrastructure of rail. So should it be the government's part of the government's responsibility here, or is it all on KiwiRail?
Well, the first thing is it's good we're having an inquiry into exactly what's happened. We actually launched a campaign in the National Party for that to happen, and the government moved really quickly. So really important we get to the bottom of exactly what happened. But it needs to just be wider than just, you know, how did we end up with just having one vehicle safety equipment on the line that wasn't, you know, essentially up to scratch. It needs to be wider. And I think the issue is this.
Isn't it a wide inquiry? Because there's three things that it's looking at. Whether KiwiRail is appropriately focused on the delivery of reliable commuter services, whether its engagement with stakeholders over the breakdown was adequate, what changes are needed to prevent a reoccurrence in the of this happening again. So isn't it a relatively wide investigation? When we're looking at it's a rapid 30
days. That's what I'm saying, is that That's what I'm saying. That's good, because the issue is this, right? The government has given KiwiRail billions of dollars over the last few years, but they have taken their eye off the ball when it comes to making sure KiwiRail actually spends that money properly. KiwiRail operates in a very funny situation. They're a state-owned enterprise, so in other words, they're separate from ministers, but they're not actually expected to turn a profit, and they're actually very close to government in the sense that ministers direct and control a lot of their expenditure. So my point is, have ministers taken their eye off the ball? I would argue they probably have when it comes to KiwiRail, and instead they've been focused on things like light rail and Auckland and other sort of vanity projects like cycle bridges across the Auckland Harbour Bridge. Actually, the ferry network across the Cook Strait is State Highway 1. Actually, the metro rail networks in Auckland and Wellington take cars off our roads and make it easier for hundreds of thousands of commuters to get to and from work and school and hospital and all of the things that the metro rail networks provide. They're fundamental to our transport system and they are failing at the moment.
Nick, can I bring you in here? Because talking about the rail network, freight is a huge part of KiwiRail's business, right? So talk to me about the disruptions that things like this cause for freight and how it gets around the rest of the country.
Well, I mean, you slow the movement of freight down and you slow the movement of people down and you cost the economy money. The economy is unable to be as productive as it should be, and that's ultimately what happens here. And so there are massive costs, there are massive disruptions as a result of, you know, very simple. You know, we're talking about one vehicle, one track checking vehicle. What I would say, and I agree with Chris entirely, you know, it's great that there is an investigation, but that investigation does need to be widened, and it can be widened, and they just need to do a quick check of what other exposures there are in the Wellington rail network, because we've got passenger rail here, we've got rail, you know, freight that comes down the island to go across, as Chris says, the State Highway 1 across the Cook Strait. We need to know what else actually is potentially a problem in the Wellington rail network, because my sense is that there are other issues here. And as I say, it comes down to a culture around our assets, around our infrastructure that we all need to change. When money's given, we need to invest in the basics, in those assets that are already in the ground, and we've got to understand the consequences of when those fail.
Chris, can I bring you back in here? Because you're talking about the government having dropped the ball here in terms of oversight. So in terms of that, and Nick, you brought it up, that we should be looking at the investment that we're making. So billions of dollars from the government's gone into the investment. So are you saying, Chris, that actually we need to have more oversight on that? What should that look like?
Well, I think there are real questions about what is the legal entity, the statutory form of KiwiRail. That sounds like a really technical question, but this half-in, half-out situation we have at the moment where KiwiRail is expected to turn a profit and is wholly independent of ministers, even though they receive billions of dollars of government money, and, of course, the failure of it needs to massive consequences, I think is up for debate. And look, to be fair to the government, that's been going back and forth over the last 10 years over successive governments. But have we got that right? I'm not sure that's correct. So we will have to have a look at that, and you know, that could potentially be included in this review. But the main point is that ministers should be demanding accountability from KiwiRail. Ultimately, this is a state-owned company, but whatever its legal entity form, it's owned by taxpayers on behalf of the people of New Zealand, and it should be running efficiently and prudently, and they should be making those investments into the rail network so that we don't have the chaos like we've seen this week in Wellington, and frankly, also in Auckland. And people sometimes forget, in Auckland, they are essentially relaying whole series of tracks in anticipation of the City Rail Link, and it is causing chaos over the next 2 years or so as they completely relay sections of various parts of the network.
Gosh, we have to wrap things up, but we haven't even talked about the ferries. Hey, you two, thank you so much again for being with us this morning and coming into the Wellington studio, Nick Leggett and Chris Bishop. Appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.